Thank you very much, Paul. We will get back to this question probably in the future. And my next question is, Paul, can I ask you a question, please? We are now, all of us, talking about the crisis related to debt, debt-driven crisis in the United States, in the Eurozone. But if we look closely, if we analyze the global consumers market at the demand which can pay in a global scale and at the production that was created in the world, and if we look at the inventories that are accumulated in the largest global companies, in the largest economies, we can probably, it can seem that we are just going down another production crisis, the crisis of overproduction. Of course, it requires some thorough calculations, but some specialists, which I was repeatedly talking to, say that the main threat are lying here. We can deal with debts little by little, but the things that run deep are in the area of global overproduction. And moreover, it is a commonplace vision that such a crisis was already ripe in the end of 1980s of the last century, but it was delayed due to the collapse of the Soviet Union, because for the global companies, new segments of global market have emerged as zones of influence of the Soviet Union and as a Soviet Union territory itself, which began to consume a lot of products in big quantities. And this global overproduction crisis was just delayed, and now it is underway legally. How do you react to this?
I've heard that view. I actually disagree quite strongly. I've never quite understood what it means to have global overproduction. It's not as if there are not people in the world who would like to buy more things. It's if you say, look, the world is producing too many automobiles. Is it producing too many automobiles if we get to a stage where the ordinary citizen of China can buy an automobile? There's enormous, essentially unlimited potential demand in the world. Nor do we actually have the wrong, to a large extent, we do not have the problem of having the wrong kinds of workers, the wrong kind of capacity. Obviously, there are some things that are not appropriate, but if we think about the things we really should be doing, investing in infrastructure, investing in construction, not of housing, but of other kinds of facilities, the unemployed workers have more or less the skills we would need to do that. No, I don't believe that this is a crisis of overproduction. This is a crisis of debt, of a collapse of demand, because the demand was sustained in ways that were not something you could rely on in the long run, but there are other routes to it. Historically, go back to the 1930s, and everything that people say now about how this is a deep-seated structural crisis, and we'll never be able to make use of this productive capacity, or workers no longer have the skills we need. People were saying exactly the same things in 1935, 1936, and then we got an economic recovery, which was generated through a large public spending program, otherwise known as the Second World War, and all of a sudden it turned out that there was no fundamental shortage either of demand or of qualified workers. This is a technical problem. As John Maynard Keynes said, he said at the time in the 1930s, we have magneto trouble, old-fashioned term. Basically, we have a problem with the electrical system. The car needs a new battery. We don't need a new car. We just need some fairly small changes to get this thing running again.
The Great Depression, as we know, ended in Second World War in a lot of devastation, and the need to recover the economy of the whole region, of the entire region of the world, the entire Europe. New products were demanded, new markets were opened. But now you have just recognized that there is a problem with a demand from people who pay. Of course, people don't want to pay. People want to get something for free. But the question is, can it be paid? But okay, I understood your position, and it was crucial for me to hear your attitude to this question. Thank you. Thank you very much. Actually, the book of Paul Krugman describes a similar situation of overproduction, the stimulus of the monetary stimulus, the over-crediting, and there are a lot of examples which it leads to and in what cases you can use this. This is a very interesting topic, but I probably think that we can give a floor to our next speaker. I would like to address the next question to you, Raghuram. Your last book about fault lines in global economy, one of the of such global fault lines, which was produced by the crisis, is a social disparity, income disparity, and it should be addressed seriously, and you have to deal. We have to deal with this. What do you think, in the conditions of budget austerity measures, will industrial countries be able to do something in this area, or this fault line will just be become more broader? And another question which I would like to address you as a specialist in financial sector, you know that we face a task of constructing an international financial center in Moscow. How do you appreciate our chances?
Thank you very much. Well, I tend to believe that the current crisis is more than just a crisis of aggregate demand. I think it's been building up for some time, and one of the ways it has built out is in what we see as popular protests around the industrial countries. And you know, one of the underlying causes, in my view, is growing income inequality. And income inequality tends to be very pernicious when people see that inequality coming not just from, you know, people's luck or people's success, but from the fact that people have very different life chances. They start life and they don't have a hope of reaching where the others have reached. In industrial countries, I think that tends to be a situation for substantial social conflict and differences in opinion about policies, which often resemble then, which lead to the kind of politics that you see in emerging markets. It seems to me that a lot of people say the one big difference between industrial countries and emerging markets is industrial countries have strong institutions, checks and balances, while emerging markets don't. I think the other big thing that keeps industrial country politics working is when they have moderate levels of inequality, when people feel they can achieve what others have achieved. When they get to a situation where they feel they can't, you get the kind of politics that you have in the emerging markets. You get more dysfunctional politics, and that is what I think many industrial countries are seeing. So where does this inequality come from? I think there are many explanations, and there's a lot of disagreement amongst experts. But I would say that three or four things are clear. One, in industrial countries, there's been technological change. Increasingly, you know, just having a high school degree doesn't let you do the kinds of jobs that are being created. Increasingly, even manufacturing jobs are getting high-tech. They're not simple manufacturing jobs. They require a degree of skills which is simply not available in the ordinary workforce. You need more training, more skill building. People with graduate degrees, people with second degrees, third degrees, tend to earn far more than people with first degrees, and those earn far more than people with high school education. Again, that's because the nature of jobs is changing. It's requiring higher order skills. And to my mind, one big source of inequality, certainly in the United States, is the fact that while the jobs and the kinds of skills they require has been increasing in magnitude, education hasn't kept pace. Too few people graduate from high school in the United States. Too few people graduate with degrees in the United States, and too many degrees are in the softer liberal arts rather than in the hard sciences, in engineering and math. And that makes people less capable of doing the kinds of jobs that are being produced. So one big source of inequality has been the technological change and the fact that education hasn't quite kept up with it. A second source of inequality, and this differs across countries, certainly in the United States, certainly in the United Kingdom, deregulation has helped increase inequality. Why? Because deregulation increases competition, increases the returns to talent. More talented people have, in a sense, gotten greater incomes in a more deregulated economy. That is not to say that deregulation always creates problems. In some of these southern European countries, the lack of deregulation, in fact, creates inequality because people who are inside, who have the jobs, are making money while people on the outside, typically the youth, are unemployed and are not making money. So deregulation can play both ways, but I think in the UK, in the United States, it has helped exacerbate inequality, especially deregulation in the financial sector, which has created fairly gigantic incomes in certain parts of the financial sector. Now, the good side of deregulation has been it has created value, it has created competition, it has created cheaper goods for people. The bad side of deregulation, if you will, is that it has exacerbated inequality by emphasizing the differences in talent. Third factor, globalization. Globalization is again another form of competition. Again, it increases the returns to talents, increases the returns to skills, especially in industrial countries. Of course, in other countries, it makes other segments of the population better off. But in general, globalization, I think, has moderately increased inequality in industrial countries. And finally, a lot of people point to taxation, that the taxation structures in industrial countries have gone towards favoring the elite. The most immediate example of this was the discussion about Mitt Romney's taxes and how he paid relatively low taxes. But put all this together, what has happened in countries like the United States, in countries like Spain, is inequality has increased, and politicians have felt a tremendous need to respond to this inequality. In a democracy, that is natural. But the way they've responded has not been to increase the capabilities of the workforce more generally, to increase the capabilities of those falling behind. How they've responded typically has been in less effective ways. In the US, to my mind, it was turning a blind eye to the expansion in credit, if not actively encouraging credit. Because, you know, while people can get frustrated seeing that their incomes aren't growing, what people ultimately care about is consumption. And in the 10 years before the crisis, the US became a consumption economy, fueled by very easy access to finance. And particularly pernicious here, particularly harmful, was housing finance. Because once you got housing finance, you saw your house appreciating in value, you could borrow against it, you could spend, and you did not feel that you were becoming poor. You went into debt without feeling you were becoming poor. You enjoyed a good life. Unfortunately, that kind of debt-fueled consumption came to an end with the crisis. Now those people who borrowed are in deep trouble, much worse trouble than they were before.